It's only 7 a.m. there, but the sun rose at 3:05 a.m., and they're going to have 19 hours of daylight today. In some places, like Alert and Eureka Nunavut, the sun won't rise or set today. They are currently in a pattern of 24 hours of sunlight that will last for about 50 days. Those are the places in Canada where the opposite happens in the winter, where for days the region is blanketed in darkness. As believers in Jesus, we know the sun is not the only source of light. We know that Jesus is the light of the world. And each week, as we begin our worship, we light the Christ candle as a visible reminder of God's light that came into the world. God's light who performed miracles and endured great hardship and then was resurrected that we might all live in the light forever. God is always with us whether the sun rises or not, even when it feels like the darkness is all around us. May this flame remind us and reassure us of Jesus' light of the world. Amen. Today is a special day and a special service to commemorate Canada Day. And so today's worship is peppered with facts and connections across our nation, many of which are printed in your bulletin and some will be spoken aloud. And I want to acknowledge that this may make some people uncomfortable, but I hope that you will stick with us throughout the service so that you can see why I have chosen to include Canada Day in our worship this morning. There are lots of announcements in your bulletin. There's lots of things coming up. There are still rhubarb pies available for sale. See Linda Link after worship if you would like one. Next Sunday is our Sunday school picnic and an intergenerational worship service. You might remember the last one. We did some surfing up here at the front. Next week, we are going to play Family Feud. It's going to be a fun-filled worship, and we will also have some extra activities for folks that have a little trouble sitting still that long. We're going to try and keep them a little more engaged this time from what we learned last time. Are there other announcements that folks would like to draw attention to? Judy?
We were supposed to have a quick AV meeting today, but we're canceling that. The companies just couldn't get back to me in time with their information, so there's no meeting today.
Thanks, Judy. Leanne?
Audrey is turning 13 today.
Happy birthday, Audrey. Are there other birthdays? Okay, let's sing happy birthday to Audrey.
That was their request this past month. Okay.
by a lady who lived in Nova Scotia. She was married to an evangelical preacher, and they went to visit this couple who had endured so much hardship throughout their lives, but this couple was just the most positive people that this woman had ever met, and she couldn't get over their positivity despite all of their hardships. And so Sybilla Martin said, "What is your secret? How can you remain so positive?" And the lady told her, "His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches me," which is a scripture from Matthew, and that is what inspired Sybilla Martin from Nova Scotia to write this hymn, "His eye is on the sparrow, your words are written in your bulletin."
Thank you. Well, this is an exciting time for many of us as we think of the changes that have taken place over the years. And I get a lot of joy now at looking at the way it used to be earlier in my life. And one of the things that happened, I was in the life insurance industry for many years and was agency manager of four different agencies over those years. And in 1979, which I know has been prehistory for some of you, I was transferred to Winnipeg. And Joan and I, we had two children at that time, Julia and Tara. And Tara was just a toddler at that time. And we found that Winnipeg, it is a beautiful city. And about half of the population in Manitoba lives in the city of Winnipeg. And in the office where our agency was located, right downtown in the Richmond building, I could see the prairie from there on the 21st floor. And if you saw orangey, yellow type coloring in the sky, you knew it was windy out there. If you were driving outside the city and you happened to see a snowbank in the middle of the summer, that's not snow, that was dust and dirt from the soil that had blown into the road. Not a good idea to drive into it unless you want to get some work for realigning the wheels of your car afterward. It's built, Winnipeg itself, on very flat land. And some of you may know that it was the bed of a lake many, many thousands of years before. And they did have quite a serious flood there back in 1956, and it's altered much of the landscape in that area. They built a floodway through much of the flooded part of the city that had flooded previously. And they put in a new perimeter road, kind of like a 400 series road, but it was built on a berm. So that if the Red River decided to flood again, there was something to stop that water. They would help sandbag the roads that went under that perimeter road and try to stay a little more dry. Farming is the main industry there. Cash crops, very often farming 3,000 to 5,000 acres. And if you could just imagine seeing 500 acres of, say, sunflowers in bloom, it is phenomenal, a real treat. And you don't measure how far away a place is by the distance, you tend to do it by time. You know, either you wonder how far it is, say, up to Lake Winnipeg, well, that's about an hour. And if you had cruise control and if the RCMP were not nearby, it may be much less time. So, it's really different when you're in a city like that and there's no one else much around except way far north. And the farming had quite an influence on what was happening. In the summer, the farmers were very, very busy working from early morning till far into the dark night often. And on the other hand, in the wintertime, they had lots of free time. So what developed in Winnipeg was a lot of curling rinks. There were bowling alleys everywhere. There were lots of support groups and gatherings of different groups of people and a lot of support for the arts, that being the only city. So there were a lot of patrons who supported, they had art. so on. The weather, you've heard it's cold out there, but it's a dry cold. It's still cold. And that's probably one of the dominating features, and we learned that first year, so we would fly home at Christmas time, and Joan's car was in the driveway, and when we got back, the battery was frozen. So we had ways to protect ourselves from that. My car, I had a car warmer inside the car. I had a battery blanket to keep it warm and a block heater. Plugged all three into one loop cord, and in those days the aerial was on the fender. So I just bring that cord back, wrap it around the aerial. And so you see all of these cars going down the road with this cord tied around the aerial. And then when I got into my parking place, there was a spot to plug it in. It was cold enough that if there wasn't any place to plug in, you would sometimes keep your car running while we were gone. It was just for a short stop and pick up a few groceries or something. And the summers, on the other hand, they were awesome. In the city, there was a free zoo and public park that you could go to, lots of golf courses, a lot of heritage celebrations that we enjoyed going to. Ukrainians, people from Iceland, there was a French quarter in Winnipeg and French in Maine. And on Lake Winnipeg, there was just a gorgeous camping site on sandy soil, and the beach was broad. Just excellent times for that. I did want to mention that finding a location in Winnipeg to live, you were kind of given advice, or certainly the agents gave me advice as to where I should live, and that was where they were living, and that was in Fort Richmond. There was no place there that we liked, but there was a new development opening up, Richmond West, and it was near the perimeter road, not quite to it. Just one road in, and there it was in the middle of the piece of prairie, still within the perimeter of Winnipeg, just one road in. And virtually everyone in there was much like we were. There were people in management positions, had been transferred in by various companies. And Joan was determined to build a community there in this little island of houses, about four small streets, and this island of prairie grass around them. So when we got there and we moved in, bought a house there, it was in the fall, and there isn't much spring or fall there. You basically move from summer to winter with maybe 3 or 4 weeks of fall there. And in the spring it was freezing cold, about 3 or 4 weeks of spring, and then you were in the summer. Dry, never worried about rain or anything like that. And anyway, when we moved in, it was in that 1 month of fall in October. And Halloween came, and Joan thought, well, this is the perfect time to get to meet some of the neighbors. So she was ready to head out. The only problem was that there was a storm coming, and it had hit before
it was a blizzard.
Night.
That it was a blizzard.
It was a blizzard. Our two young girls had to follow their mom. They were dressed up in their Halloween costumes and winter coats. And I think it was the first house that Joan saw lights on. She was invited in and told she was crazy. But in any event, they were invited in for some visiting and some hot cocoa. They had two daughters, about the same age as $8. And that family is in fact still friends of ours now. He worked at Snyder's and, like many of us, was in a middle management position. And about a month after we moved, he got notice that he was being transferred to Kitchener, where I got transferred back after 4 years. And Ray and I, we really didn't have much to say about the matter. We had bought in an area in Kitchener, and Joanne and Joan were determined that they were going to live within a few houses of us, just like they had in Winnipeg. There was one available. So Ray, being the good husband that he was, he just stayed out of it. And a few days after our transfer back to Kitchener, they were transferred back from place in Manitoba, and we've been friends ever since. When we got there, as well, the Halloween, that was kind of our introduction to winter. So we thought, well, another way to get to know some of the neighbors would be to have a euchre party. So Joan sent out pamphlets, delivered pamphlets to all of the houses in three or four blocks there in the area, inviting them to our place for a euchre party. A ton of people showed up, and none of them had any idea what euchre was. But they were happy to come. So we taught them how to play euchre, and after that it developed that there were monthly couples clubs that we'd get together for a party in the neighborhood. We got permission, Joan and other women particularly, to close off the main street there for a block party. And they were a lot of fun each year. We had them when the street was closed for that. There was a parade of kids. They decorated up their bikes, and moms decorated up the strollers, and there was potluck food. And there was a clown, and one of the highlights was a leg contest for men. And there was a group of women who were the judges. So in a garage with the door open about so high, men's legs were there all decorated. And this group of women, they would decide who was going to be the prize winner of the leg. But technically that was that the ladies were voting for her. And then when Brett was 2 weeks old, he got to fly back to Toronto and then moved to our home again in Kitchener. So Brett's the one in our family that has a birth certificate from Manitoba. In any event, that's some of what went on. It was a wonderful time, wonderful memories. So I'm wondering now if you would like to join me in the call to worship and the opening prayer. It is printed in the order of service. We will begin there. As Canada begins another year, we come with praise and with thanksgiving.
For the beauty and majesty of this land and the diversity of its people.
We come too with concern and the desire for hope.
That the environment will be protected, that truth and reconciliation will be advanced, and that all people will live in harmony.
Holding these desires and concerns in our hearts, let us pray.
Holy Spirit, help us to trust that you are at work among us, moving our country in the right direction. Stir the conscience of our leaders and citizens to make the decisions that bless all people and all creatures to share their center. Help people to learn to trust in one another, to name the best in each other, and to be moved to share with each other. Fill us with the trust in you and in each other that inspires sharing for the good of all and engaging in the work of reconciliation. May the prayer that Jesus taught us inspire us as we share together.
Keen and bright, a shame for
sure. I started on the wrong one.
brothers, if one of you is caught in any sin, the more spiritual among you should correct the offender in a spirit of gentleness, remembering that you may be tempted yourselves. Bear one another's burdens and thus fulfill the law of Christ. But if you think you are important when you are not, you are deceiving yourself. Examine your own work, each of you. If you find something to boast about, at least it's something of your own and not just empty comparison with your neighbor. Carry your own load. Those under instruction in the word should always contribute to the support of the instructor. Don't be deceived. God cannot be cheated. Where you sow, there you will reap. If you sow in the field of self-indulgence, you will reap corruption. If you sow in the field of the Spirit, you will reap the harvest of eternal life. Never grow tired of doing good. We will reap a harvest at the proper time if we don't grow weary. So while we still have time, do good to all, and especially to those of the household of faith. And so, what I really wanted us to get out of that scripture today was that if I want to grow watermelons, I need to sow watermelon seeds. If I really want to grow corn, I can't plant strawberries and just hope for the best. We have to plant the seeds that we want. So if these say Pastor Don seeds, and so if the seeds in my packet are anger, deceit, bitterness, mean words, and lies, those are the things that I will reap, that I will harvest. And so may the seeds of our packets be good ones, be gentleness, love, kindness, generosity, goodness, and patience. Let's pray. Loving and gracious God, we give thanks for the children in our midst, for the seeds of love we hope that are planted in this place, not only in their hearts, but in all of ours. And we just pray, Holy God, that the seeds in our own packets are those of the gifts of the Spirit, the ones that you call us to put forward, that we might harvest those good things and let go of the tough ones. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I invite Judy Hauser to come and share with us our second scripture this morning and to share with us a little bit about her connection to Newfoundland.
Scripture reading is from 2 Kings chapter 5. Now Naaman was commander of the army of the king of Aram. He was a great man in the sight of his master and highly regarded, because through him the Lord had given victory to Aram. He was a valiant soldier, but he had leprosy. Now hands of the raiders from Aram had gone out and had taken captive a young girl from Israel, and she served Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "If only my master would see the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy." Naaman went to his master and told him what the girl from Israel had said. By all means go, the king of Aram replied, I will send a letter to the king of Israel. So Naaman left, taking with him the 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 sets of clothing. The letter that he took to the king of the Israel read, with this letter I am sending my servant Naaman to you so that you may cure him of his leprosy. As soon as the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his robes and said, am I God? Can I kill and bring back to life? Why does this fellow send someone to me to be cured of his leprosy? See how he is trying to pick a quarrel with me. When Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his robes, he sent him this message. Why have you torn your robes? Have the man come to me, and he will know that there is a prophet in Israel. So Naaman went with him, with his horses, rather, and chariots, and stopped at the door of Elisha, of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to say to him, go wash yourself 7 times in the Jordan, and your flesh will be restored, and you will be clean, cleansed. But Naaman went away angry and said, I thought that he would surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord God, his God, wave his hand over the spots, and cure me of my leprosy. Are not Aram and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Couldn't I wash in them and be clean? So he turned and went off in a rage. Naaman's servant went to him and said, my father, if the prophet had told you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? How much more then, when he tells you, wash and be cleansed? So he went down and dipped himself in the Jordan 7 times, as the man of God had told him, and his flesh was restored and became clean like that of a young boy. Now I'll share with you about Newfoundland. After visiting Newfoundland for the first time in 1998 for just 11 days and loving it and its friendly people, the incredible icebergs, the puffins, and I'm wearing a puffin brooch, and the scenery, and wanting to see more of it, this big island, the rock, I found a pen pal from Twillingate in a magazine I was looking through at my chiropractor office. I wrote a letter to this person, not realizing till much later that this magazine was years old. I was lucky that she was still living. I wrote to her, and after a while, quite a while actually, she wrote back. And that was the beginning of a long friendship. We corresponded for over 15 years, roughly. She called herself a Newfie pal. She had many pen pals, and they were all pals, and she would sign her Newfie pal when she wrote a letter. We were able to visit her twice. She welcomed us into her home and toured us around her town. And I never knew how my way around in that place. It was up and down, and the streets were so different. And I don't know how we arrived back at her house. So I couldn't have done it. Anyway, she pointed out the lighthouse. We did go to the lighthouse and got some pictures. Restaurants, churches. We attended a concert by the group, I don't know if you've heard of it, the Split Peas. And that was quite enjoyable, and they had a lot of audience participation in that. We also enjoyed a chicken, or you could have a lobster meal, followed by a comedy show. Virginia took us to the United Church in Twillen Gate. She knew the pastor there, even though she didn't attend that church. She was of the Pentecostal faith. She knew most everyone in her town, and they knew her, and they called her Jenny. Most of the people knew her. She was a crafty lady and showed us her knitting projects, which she had for sale and in several craft shops. I own some of her knitting items, like socks, and she had a map of Newfoundland knitted into the socks. Our second visit was to be our last for visiting her. Sadly, she passed away this past December after moving into an assisted living accommodation. I will remember her warm and caring nature and her love for her family and friends. And thanks for letting me share that. And hope to go back to Newfoundland someday. It's just beautiful, beautiful island. The citizens there are so friendly, and it's really nice. Thank you.
Thanks for sharing. Let's pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts bring you glory, Holy God. Amen. I wonder if you can think of a time when you felt desperate, a time when you wanted something so badly that you were willing to try just about anything. Perhaps you were so broke that you took out one of those payday loans with a gigantic interest rate, or maybe it wasn't a loan, maybe it was a vehicle with a ridiculous interest rate that you desperately needed wheels. Maybe you were desperate for companionship, so you hung around people you didn't really like, people who were toxic that you knew were no good for you. Maybe you were desperate for something medical related, fertility or healing, and you were willing to travel to a back alley or a foreign country to try whatever someone suggested might work. Naaman, commander of the king of Aram's army, was a desperate man. He had leprosy. With that diagnosis, it didn't matter how many battles he won or how much respect he commanded from everyone, he was now considered unclean. He had to quarantine. No one would go near him. He was desperate, the kind of desperation that sometimes pushes people to search for unconventional solutions to serious problems, like rash loans, abusive relationships, or black market medicines. So he took the advice of a little girl, sort of. His wife's servant girl told him to go and see the prophet Elisha back in her home country. But instead of going to the house of the prophet, he went to Israel's king's palace, because Naaman, he thought he was a big deal. He was commander of his king's army. He He was powerful and important, so he went to see the king. Only the king got angry. He couldn't heal leprosy. But then the prophet Elisha found out about Naaman coming to Israel. He discovered that the king was upset, so he sent word to the king, "Send Naaman to me, I'll look after him." But Naaman was annoyed. He'd been shuffled off to someone else. But away he went to Elisha's door, and Elisha then sent a servant to tell Naaman to go and wash in the Jordan River 7 times, and he'd be healed. Naaman thinks to himself, "Are you kidding me?" I feel like it's probably similar to that feeling when you've tried everything with your computer or your cell phone or maybe the TV, and you can't get it to work, so you call customer service and you wait on hold, and then you wait some more, and then someone answers, but it's the billing department, so they transfer you to someone else, and that's the wrong department too, so they transfer you again, and then that person says, "Well, have you tried turning it off and rebooting it? Are you kidding me?" Naaman's like, "Wash in the river? Are you kidding me? Of course I've tried washing. Is the Jordan River really any different than all the bodies of water we have back home? Seriously, the river and the sea back home are a lot cleaner than that muddy cesspool. Wash myself in the muddy Jordan? Who does this guy think he is? He won't even come to the door and speak to me. This is ridiculous." That's putting it mildly, of course, because the Bible says Naaman went off in a rage. But Naaman's servants go to him and try to talk him down. If the prophet had told you to do something huge, wouldn't you do it? They said. If the prophet had told you to go out into the desert and find the rarest yellow cactus fruit and take it up the mountain to the highest peak and roast it over a fire made of olive tree wood at the break of dawn on the 12th day of the 3rd month, would you do it? Of course. So why don't you try this simple task? Why don't you just try turning it off and on? Why don't you just try bathing in the Jordan River 7 times? And sure enough, it worked. 7 times in the Jordan, and Naaman's leprosy was healed. It was the first little servant girl of Naaman's wife, and then his servant, who were with him in Israel, whose voices were filled with wisdom and unexpected grace. Naaman just had to let go of his ego and humble himself and listen. How often do our own egos get in the way of our listening, our learning, our healing? I wonder whose voices are bringing wisdom and grace today. Normally, I wouldn't address Canada Day in worship as I have this morning. It's a national holiday. It has nothing to do with Jesus. But when I read the scripture for this morning about Naaman, I couldn't help but think about Canada Day and how last year there were many calls to cancel Canada Day celebrations across the nation after the grim discoveries of hundreds of children's bodies buried at residential school sites. Since then, more burial sites have been uncovered, but this year, July 1st festivities have gone ahead with considerable excitement, and we do have things to celebrate. Canada is a great place to live. It is a land of exquisite beauty and magnificent landscapes. We have mostly peace, mostly democracy, and there is a freedom that newcomers to Canada understand better than most of us and want to celebrate. But at the same time, we must humble ourselves. We must acknowledge the pain of the past. We must acknowledge our white privilege. White privilege is an institutional rather than a personal set of benefits granted to those of us who by race resemble the people who dominate the powerful positions in our institutions. Yes, we are not the settlers who first arrived here, nor were we in positions of power organizing residential schools or calling for Indigenous children to be taken there, but by the color of our skin, we have a degree of privilege we must recognize, and we must acknowledge the history and pain and the complicated impacts of colonization. Before there can be reconciliation, there must be truth. And the truth is, horrible, tragic things happened. We must strive to learn the truth about colonization, the things that were not taught to us in school, the things that were left out of the history books. We must hold ourselves and others accountable when we've overstepped boundaries or fell short of understanding our privilege. This could be as simple as using incorrect language, forgetting to acknowledge the traditional territories, or laughing at racist jokes. Here's an example. Did you know that the special clothing worn at powwows are called regalia and not costumes? There is a profound difference. Costumes are something that you put on when you are pretending that you're something that you're not, whereas traditional outfits or regalia is a way of connecting Indigenous people with their culture, cultural heritage, and spiritual practice. That may seem simple, using the wrong word, but it is an example of how we can offend or be offensive unintentionally. An example, moving forward, of what Maya Angelou meant when she said, "Do the best you can until you know better. Then when you know better, do better." So folks dancing in traditional clothing at powwows are not in costume. They are wearing regalia. And if you hear someone else make the mistake of calling it a costume, you can gently inform them of the proper term. That's how we do better. I'm sure it's happened to you before. You've witnessed someone use the wrong word or a racial slur or a racist joke. You're at a crossroads. Do you speak up or do you leave the moment and its default comfort intact? You ask yourself, who am I to disrupt this pleasant day with my politics? What if they think I'm a troublemaker? What if I'm seen as not nice? Each of us has been conditioned to collude with some form of racism for the sake of preserving the default comfort. Consequently, we give way to continued oppression. That's our white privilege, and we must acknowledge it if we truly want reconciliation. Our collective assignment is to challenge indoctrinations. There will be times when those challenges must be aggressive, and there will be times when our choice to quietly but publicly call out racism will be the seed needed to change hearts. Each invitation to risk social comfort for an act of justice disturbs the social contract of racism. Even a small wrinkle in the bed of privilege is enough to force some of us awake. It is in our awakening that we gain the collective power to bring into being a transformed country built on radical and unapologetic love. May we be open to the wisdom of the Holy Spirit guiding us day by day in the small voices that we hear. May we humble ourselves, set our egos aside, and really listen. And when presented with the opportunity to use our own voices, to share a little wisdom, may we upset the apple cart, the default comfort of a situation, and plant a seed of love that might grow towards true reconciliation. In our festivities this weekend, in the joy of gathering and celebrating connections across our nation, may we also humbly acknowledge the complicated past of Canada and commit to doing better because we know better. And together, may we dream about the country that we hope to become, a country where all are free to be their best selves and to live their best lives. Thanks be to God. Amen. I think we will skip this hymn and move on to a litany of reflection. Andy to come and join us. And Kate's going to share with us a little bit about her connection to British Columbia.
In 1968, Mom and Dad packed up their four kids, aged 6 to 12, in a station wagon and created a memorable trip, a camping trip, to British Columbia. While there, we enjoyed visits with my mom's great aunts and other family members who had settled in the Vancouver area decades earlier. Fast forward 40 years. Nick and I were in northern BC. My aunts and uncles lived there. Sorry, his aunts and uncles lived there. I'm reading his part. And our daughter was enjoying an optometry internship. Who knew that Lisanne and her new husband would make New Westminster in the Vancouver area their home? To complete our family connections to this western province, my brother and sister-in-law moved from Halifax to Vancouver. And shortly after, their daughters also moved west and have established their own homes with great partners and pets. British Columbia, where key family members live, is very closely to Nick and I. Oh, Canada, our home and native land.
Indigenous land respected and valued.
True patriot love in all of us command.
True compassionate love in all of us by God's hand.
With glowing hearts, we see thee rise.
With aching hearts, we realize
the true north, strong and free,
was bought with many others' blood and tears.
From far and wide, O Canada,
people came to colonize.
We stand on guard for thee.
But liberty has not always been shared.
God keep our land glorious and free.
May the promise of Canada continue to be.
O Canada, we stand on guard for thee.
A land of unity, hopes, dreams, and diversity.
O Canada, we stand on guard for thee.
May this be our legacy by the grace of God.
Thank you. Let's pray. God of steadfast love, we are thankful for the beauty of Canada and for its diverse landscapes, weather, and people. We are thankful for the opportunity to make connections and hear of adventures and learn about one another here in this sacred place. We acknowledge the complicated past of our country and we long to be part of a better, kinder, more equitable, and peaceful future. We pray today, Holy Mystery, for the countries far from us who are living in constant violence, terrorism, and war, particularly the countries of Ukraine and Russia. We pray for an end to the war, for peace to reign. We pray for the country nearest to us, for the United States, where political decisions have recently been made that have many completely distraught. We pray for the women who no longer have control over their own bodies, for those who have lost their jobs, for those who are now and will one day be so desperate for a solution that they will seek out dangerous back alley transactions. We pray for the LGBTQ2+ community abroad and here at home, who continue to face discrimination, physical danger, and we especially remember today those children and youth whose safe place to be themselves was at school, who now have to endure a summer without their support network. Almighty Creator, we pray for all the children and youth who have completed another year of school and find themselves with the freedom of summer. May their holiday be a time of renewal, and we pray that you would watch over them and keep them safe. We pray for the parents who now must juggle summer schedules with work, and give thanks for the grandparents, aunts, uncles, and friends who help out. We pray for the teachers, support staff, and bus drivers who are breathing a little easier this week. May they find ways to relax and regroup. Holy God, we pray for all those who are grieving, those who have recently lost loved ones, and those whose grief is flaring up because of anniversaries, memories, or life circumstances. We pray that they find comfort knowing that they are never alone, that you are with them, and that this community, their church family, holds them in prayer and longs for their hearts to heal. We pray, God, for those who are undergoing treatments, suffering from medication side effects, those who have been given unpleasant diagnosis, and those who are still waiting for tests and appointments, and whom doctors cannot pinpoint causes. We pray for those in hospital and those recovering at home. We pray for those in long-term care. May all those whom we are concerned about and praying for see the light and love of Jesus in their caregivers. Thank you, Almighty God, for the caregivers and for our friends, for Jesus, who is always with us, challenging us, strengthening us, and loving us. In his name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 664. Let's sing the first and last verse together. Go and plant seeds. Go and share the love.